Comecemos então com o primeiro painel de hoje, que está focado na dicotomia entre a segurança e os direitos humanos. Sabemos que a guerra e o conflito estiveram sempre presentes na história da humanidade, mas os problemas ambientais, económicos e tecnológicos que vivemos agravam as dificuldades dos que vivem em contextos sociopolíticos muito mais frágeis. Há hoje uma conjuntura global que possibilita a circulação de armas, de informação, de pessoas, algo nunca antes visto e que motiva a intervenção da comunidade internacional. A pergunta que o próximo painel vai tentar responder é: de que forma se podem harmonizar políticas de segurança regionais com a assistência humanitária e a proteção de direitos fundamentais à escala global? A moderadora do painel de debate Crises, em tempo de crise, entre a segurança e os direitos humanos, é Raquel Patrício Gomes, que lidera a equipa de imprensa da representação da Comissão Europeia em Portugal. Temos neste painel três oradores. A Ana Isabel Xavier, investigadora, professora auxiliar de Relações Internacionais na UAL e ISCTE, foi subdiretora-geral de Política de Defesa Nacional de 2015 a 2017. Ronen Hoffman, académico e político israelita, é professor no Centro Interdisciplinar da Lauder School of Government, em Herzliya. Especialista em gestão de crises, resolução de conflitos e política antiterrorismo. Spiridon Flogaitis, professor de Direito Público na Faculdade de Direito da Universidade de Atenas, diretor da European Public Law Organization, já desempenhou o cargo de presidente do Tribunal Administrativo das Nações Unidas, um de vários cargos, nomeadamente no governo do seu país, a Grécia. E o chair é Ari Kakowitz, professor de Relações Internacionais na Universidade Hebraica de Jerusalém, leciona cursos nas áreas das negociações de paz no Médio Oriente, teorias das relações internacionais, relações internacionais no contexto da América Latina e globalização e relações internacionais. No final deste painel haverá um período para perguntas e respostas. Podem sentar-se, may seat, please. Haverá um período para perguntas e respostas. No entanto, podem também optar pela app, pela Meet Talent. Podem fazer o download tanto no Google Play como na App Store. Para já, coloquem os vossos telemóveis no silêncio, por favor. Ari, it's up to you now.
Bom dia, good morning, everybody. I think we're running late. We're 15 minutes late, but hopefully we'll get 1 hour. But I got only 7 minutes of glory. So I'm Ari Katsovich, teaching 27 years at the Hebrew University, international relations, and it's always a pleasure to come back to the Estoril conferences. I want to thank the organizers, Teresa, Rui, and all the wonderful staff. So they volunteered me to try to do in 6.5 minutes to give you the rationale of the panel. And I'm, unlike some of my colleagues here, I'm not a practitioner, I do theory. So the title is Crisis in Times of Crisis, Between Security and Human Rights. And what I will try to do is four things: define the concepts, give you the problematic, the problem, the dilemmas, say something a bit philosophical, and then present the two case studies. First thing I think we didn't do in those two dates is to define the terms we are talking about. Crisis comes from Greek. It's crisis that you have immediate threats, but it's also opportunities in Chinese. Justice, that's the main theme of the conference. Global justice, we think about justice in terms of fairness, reciprocity. That's what we had in the last 2 days. We are concerned with justice because of inequality and equal distribution of wealth. Then we have a term, security, which is crucial to this panel, and in a sense, it's a very complicated one. I can give you three different ways of thinking about security. Ronen and I come from Israel, so we think about security in a very physical sense, in territorial terms, national security, external challenges to sovereignty. There is a second dimension that was mentioned yesterday by Eddie Schaffer, by Benedetta Berti, which is human security. Human security, it's different from national security. It refers to individuals that they want freedom, that they want freedom from violence, that they want basic human rights. And then there is a third dimension of security that was mentioned by Zakaria yesterday in the last panel, which is what we call ontological security, the security regarding your identity, that in Europe and in other places, people are afraid of the other. So that's another dimension of security. And all of that comes under the term of securitization. What do we mean by that? When we turn any problem into a security problem. So here in Europe, you are afraid of immigrants, so they become the security threat. And then we have human rights, which is the other part of the equation. And I don't have much time. I think I'm running. I have 3 or 4 minutes left, or even less. But human rights, we can talk about political and civil rights. We can talk about social, economic rights. Depends what we are thinking and in which country. So that's definitions. So let's talk about the problematic. I would rephrase the question of the panel, and the question we have to ask, can we reconcile considerations of security with considerations of human rights? Your Attorney General yesterday from Portugal, she was mentioning the example at the airport. They check us, they violate our basic human right in the name of security against terrorism. That's one example. So if you want to fight terrorism, to what extent can you violate human rights? Another way of looking at the dilemma are dilemmas of humanitarian intervention. What are the duties of countries beyond their borders? So there are many different dilemmas there. To put that in philosophical terms, you can say you have here 3 different logics. You have the realpolitik, power politics logic of national security, does not allow much for human rights. And then you have 2 liberal logics, one which we call communitarian, that refers to the right of self-determination. And then you have a cosmopolitan one, which is pretty much in the spirit of this conference, right? Which is universal human rights. Now, let's move to the praxis very quickly, since I'm running out of time. You are going to hear in this panel about 2 different cases or 2 different regions. Ronen will have the formidable task to explain you in a nutshell about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Yesterday in the conference, we already hear cases referring how Israel violates human rights. But it's much more complicated. In a nutshell, I would say you have 2 peoples disputing the same piece of land. So how you resolve that, that's a big question for our entire conference. Second case is the European case. And we have here 2 colleagues that will tell you about the relative failures of the European Common Security Policy regarding the humanitarian crisis dealing with refugees. I can tell you, 2 years ago here at Estoril, we had a conference dealing with refugees and dealing with migrants. And what I told them then, I'm telling you now again. I think that here in Europe, you are over-concerned with the 1 million refugees, where the major problem remains in the Middle East. Lebanon, Jordan, Turkey, those are the countries that receive millions of refugees. But the European case is an excellent example of that dilemma. How you reconcile security concerns with human rights. Because what happened here, and it's happening in other parts of the world, as it was explained by Dr. Zakaria yesterday, is that the fear of the other make them into a security threat. So enjoy the panel. I'm done with my 7 minutes. Thank you very much.
So good morning, and thank you for being here. It's not easy for an early morning talk, but we have a wonderful panel with 3 experienced persons in discussing these issues. And I would like just to start thanking the organization, because at the entrance of the building, we do have those giant letters saying change the world. And I think we should be thankful, because today we have an opportunity of changing the world. So again, a big round of applause for our 3 speakers. So I invite you to wake up a bit. Thank you very much, Anna and Ronen and Spiridon. And I would start putting two figures on the table. Accordingly to Eurobarometer number 90, there are two main issues of concern of Europeans, so that Europeans think that the EU should be concerned with. And the first one is immigration with 40%, and the second one is terrorism with 20%. So for Europeans, these are the issues that Europe should address. And we have these three experienced speakers here. And the first round, and I would ask you just to be quite short in addressing this first question for you. Which crisis would you identify as being the top issue in the world's agenda? So shall I start with Anna? So Anna, please.
Thank you so much, Raquel. Good morning, all. Thank you so much for being here, and thank you so much for inviting me. It's a huge privilege for me. I would say, for sure, the discredit of multilateralism and the dismantling of the representative democracy. We can, as academics, define crises in different ways, but it's obvious that after the end of the Cold War, we are all witnessing a major change in our international relations arena. That has to do with human security, as our chair has explicitly mentioned in the introduction. That has to do with this contradiction between new and old wars, but mostly has to do with a strategic environment that is changing, that is more transnational, less predictable, and less manageable. And that's how terrorism and migration arises as transnational threats that always existed, but it seems that they were happening in the other part of the world. And we as Europeans, we're not used to see migration as a threat or a terrorism as a major threat. So in my opinion, major crisis nowadays, discredit of multilateralism, and also a major change in how we perceive democracy, representative democracy, and its major critics in terms of the representation of the population. And we have seen that very recently in the European Parliament elections, when the turnout was bigger than 5 years ago, but still, we are still facing a major crisis in the way we address people and how people address the rules of engagement and the government that represent them.
And now, would you bring, of course, a specific geographic, I would say, and political experience. What's your view on this? What's the crisis from your experience and from your point of view?
Well, I may say something as an Israeli and say something as a citizen of the Middle East, of the region. As a person who lives in the Middle East, the entire region is for a while being in a turbulent kind of dynamics, very wild dynamics of changes. And I think that that is the most problematic aspect of people who try to stabilize their lives in the region. To get used to live in such uncertainty in terms of who are the political leaderships, who are the leaders, what do you need to do in order to get freedom? If you want to get freedom, do you have to protest? Do you have to go on the streets because the regimes are not being democracies? If you want to have freedom, you go to protest on the streets. What does it mean? What the future will bring to you? The region is not that experienced in creating structures and mechanisms of liberal democracies or any kind of democracies. So the chaos has been sustainable, unfortunately, in the region. And the region has come to be very tribal in many senses. So I think this is, in the Middle East, this is the main problem. As an Israeli, it's even more complicated than that because we are a liberal democracy. For us, a liberal democracy is a need, is almost an existential need of our identity. But there's an asymmetry between Israel as a liberal democracy and the entire region that is not a democracy at all. And given the conflict between Israel and some of the Arab players in the region, it creates a situation, almost an impossible situation, and maybe we'll discuss it later, between security and human rights.
Yes, exactly. And Spiridon, as a Greek, also an important country when it comes to talk about immigration and about security. What's your feeling, not only from a law perspective, of course, but I'm very much interested in listening to you as a Greek.
Well, you mentioned immigration and also I would say that there are a few issues which are very modern and which are interconnected. I will, of course, focus on the migration issue, but migration goes together with human trafficking, money laundering, with terrorism very often. Not always, but very often. And so the wish to control those situations is imperative for the modern world. Now, Greece, as you know, is the country the most remote to the east, southeast of the European Union, and receives a very big burden by this flow of immigrants and this flow of refugees. The two cases are not the same. And the legal status of each one of the two categories is not the same. However, I have personally dealt with this issue twice in my life. Once in 2009, once in September 2015, I was serving as a minister in those two periods. I can tell you for what concerns the immigrants. The truth is that the immigrants start from all over the world, especially from sub-Saharan Africa. They go to Morocco, they try to go on. If they cannot, they continue, they go all around, they go to Turkey, and then they arrive to us. Of course, the refugees is another issue, is the crisis of the Middle East bringing refugees to Greece. However, when they arrive to Greece, you don't know who is refugee, who is immigrant. And because all of them arrive in the same way. They go to Turkey, they get a boat, and they pass the waters of Turkey. They arrive to the borderline with Greece in the waters. They sunk the boat, and we have to rescue them. And we are very proud of rescuing them. Truly we are, because we rescue lives. However, they have cheated us by the way they come. So as soon as they come on our islands, then I believe this is the moment they decide if they will declare themselves as refugees or as immigrants and where they come from. I have evidence that very often it needs about 6 months for the authorities to find out where they come from. They start saying that they come from Afghanistan, but they come from Mali. And so this is a very difficult issue to handle, and Europe has failed to deal with the problem. I can develop
that,
but
we will develop that idea. I think that we could start also with the causes, with the root causes, and I think it's a good angle just to listen from you, your analysis regarding the Arab world and what's going on there.
Yeah.
Why is it so difficult to solve?
So, as I mentioned, the asymmetry between some states, countries who seek stability and have created a very, I would say, balanced structures of choosing, electing their leaderships, and then also have created a tools that the public actually hold in their hands in order to limit the power of the political leaderships. This, all of this has not been created in an effective way yet in the Middle East, in the most of the Middle East. And so the outcome of it is that we're talking about almost the Middle East, we speak about almost 400 million people, who most of them are either under very powerful dictatorship or as some kind of a regime that do not respect rights of the people, or civil wars and other chaotic places throughout the region who were able to overthrow the political leaderships but still failed to create an alternative which will be more stable for the, and balanced for the long time. That is, I think, the core of, or at least the political core of the problem. But there is a deeper kind of level to that, and I think that Arye has mentioned it in, at the beginning in his notes. The crisis, the clash, is a clash of identities. And before, I think, before we go to, we get to the level of speaking about rights of freedom of speech and you know, very kind of structural legal human rights, the most basic right is the right to exist. And the right to exist is connected to a sense of recognition. Do you recognize the other's right to exist? And so as long as in the region there are still many players who do not feel and experience that mutual recognition vis-a-vis other groups around them, we cannot move or jump to a higher level or a higher discussion of the level of human rights, who are more specific and more structured. We're still in the clashes of identities, and the clash between identities is still the core problem of the region.
And so you think it makes quite difficult to bring together those identities, and it's almost like an emotional issue.
Yeah.
And it comes really at political level difficult to solve.
Sure, it is also reflected very well. It's being reflected very well in even in the conflict management, specific conflict, the conflict between Israel and the Palestinians, for example. So along our borders, on the northern border, we have to face a mini-state organization, terror organization, it's called Hezbollah, a Shiite organization, which is actually a proxy of Iran. On our southern border, we have to face Hamas, a Sunni Palestinian organization that hold the ideology of Muslim Brotherhood. Both of these organizations, who have quite impressive rocket fire that they can actually threat our security at any given moment, both of them do not recognize our right to exist in the most basic sense of the term. And so it is being reflected also in the strategy of warfare, for example. What they do, they, in order to launch rockets and missiles on Israel, they would use civilians in Gaza or in Lebanon as human shields. They will launch missiles from basements of hospitals, from ground floor of schools, from living room of private houses. Israel is very limited in what we can do in order to retaliate, because we respect human rights. And so the asymmetry is not just in the identity, it's also being translated and reflected in actual warfare.
Which makes quite difficult to solve and to balance this issue between security and human rights. And Spiridon said that Europe failed in managing migration, although we can speak about a decrease of 90% of illegal flows arriving to Europe. And what's your feeling regarding the action of the European Union has a block? So Europe should not be a fortress, at least President Juncker says so. So how do you see that, and how do you see the common security policy playing a role on that?
Yes, well, for me, I think the US failed in terms of solidarity. That's the biggest failure of the EU. And probably the EU as such is still failing, because nowadays the biggest challenge for the EU is to actually integrate those people and make them part of our European identity and citizenship. And we have to struggle now with a lot of problems in the EU, namely the radicalization and counter-radicalization of thousands of people that feel abandoned in the EU. So we have a lot of problems to struggle, along with the fact that the EU needs migration, because we are getting old and we need a qualified migration. But theoretically, in terms of toolbox, the European Union didn't fail as much. Since 2010, and then mostly since 2015, the EU has managed to accomplish a lot of political, security, and military goals. In terms of political, the EU has an European agenda on migration with short, medium, and long-term measures, both to struggle the legal migration and illegal immigration, also bearing in mind the need of a common policy in terms of asylum and migration, but distinguish what is migrant, what is an economic migrant, and what is a person that is entitled to a refugee status. Also in terms of security, it was important the agreement that the member states and the EU did with Turkey, but also with the Balkan states. They are both very important routes to come to Europe, both from the south and both from the, and of course from the east. And of course the fact that we are now building in Europe a European board and coast guard that will reinforce and strengthen our external borders. But that is everything related with the securitization of migration and with the reinforcement of a narrative that is mainly against the threat of our external borders. What the European Union also managed to do, or tried to manage to do, it was, as you mentioned, try to go to the root causes of the conflict. So that's why in 2015, the European Union deployed a military operation called UNAFOR Med Sophia, which is still ongoing, although in a very final phase. And theoretically, it was a very interesting mission because for the first time, the European Union was in Libya trying to focus in the fact that the root causes were saying that there was a lot of smuggling of boats and of people. So it was important to stop this problem in the origin, not only in the transit or in the destination countries. However, what we have witnessed in the last few months, it was that UNAFOR Med Sophia became a humanitarian mission in action. Because in fact, what the EU mission is doing in practice is to save lives. And they have to do that because the international law obeys and obliges the EU to do so. So I would say that there was a big failure in terms of solidarity of the 28 member states, and we saw that in terms of the attempt of burden sharing, the division of the migrants and refugees throughout the 28. But theoretically, in terms of institutional framework, it was quite clear that the European Union attempted to do so in terms of political, security, and military toolbox. And the CSTP is very important, our common security and defense policy is very important also, because we are trying to put in practice what the EU preaches. And we know that sometimes the EU does not practice what it preaches. But in this case, UNAFOR Med Sophia was, in theory, a great idea to go to the roots of the conflict, to build resilience, to build a sustainable a country, and of course to empower people, because when the European Union has a European neighborhood policy in the south, where Libya and Syria are also included, and when the European Union says, okay, we give you more money, but you have to give us more democracy, it means that the European Union is sustained in three main pillars: good governance, rule of law, and human rights. And the EU is actually trying to do that in practice. Now, the biggest challenge is to put that in practice in the EU. And once again, terrorist migration is only a threat because there was the securitization of migration and there was an audience that was securitized to perceive that that is a major threat and not an opportunity.
And that's a good point to go back to, Spiridon. This question of turning migration into a security issue. Let's move from the European level and the political will of member states to the ground. So what's your view regarding the reaction of political parties in countries like Italy or Greece? Are these parties making use of fear and another interpretation of migration to sell their message and somehow to promote this sort of populism among Europeans?
Well, it's thank you for the question. Actually, I believe that the traditional political forces made a mistake which is now leading to a bigger problem in our societies. The mistake has been that they have not wanted to tell the truth and recognize that there is a problem. So they left the recognition of the problem to the crazy ones, to the populists, they call them, to the extremists. So why they are extremists, why they are populists? Because, not because of recognizing, of accepting the problem, but because of the solutions they give. So what is so the problem of modern democracy in Europe? That the traditional political forces, at the end of the day, have not produced solutions. And it needs a lot of work to produce solutions. The solutions are not those which are proposed by the populists. And the populists, they know it very well, but they get the votes because the people need to vote for someone who tells them a proposal, be it a stupid proposal. Now let us be more specific. For immigration, there is the legal framework and there is realities. Let us go to realities. Someone who comes to my country or to Italy or to other countries, he will be controlled in the first steps of his presence in the country, but after a number of months, he will be given a paper and he will disappear in central Athens or in Greece, or he will find his way to go to Germany, because the most of them do not want to stay in Greece. They want to go to find their brothers and sisters in Paris, in London, or in Berlin. Now, in order to do that, they will go to prostitution, they will go to drug dealing, they will go to the black market and become slaves of the Greeks or of Italians or of others who will give them something in order to survive. They need to survive. How are they going to survive? That's why I said before that the issues are interconnected. And from what I read, they need to make a lot of money because they need to pay those who brought them here. It's a substantial amount of money. Now, we need solutions, and everything starts with recognizing that there is a problem. In my times, in September 15, the big issue was relocation. And relocation is continuous bringing problems. And now, because countries like the Visegrad countries did not want to follow the relocation policies, and perhaps now they will be brought to the European Court of Justice. Let us take the example of Hungary, what the relocation issue is. Hungary should take 500 immigrants. Hungary knows, number one, that the 500 immigrants is nothing, and second, that the 500 immigrants which will be relocated in Hungary will leave the country overnight as quickly as they can to go to Germany and be better paid. What, I mean, the Hungarians are not well paid to survive, to have a salary. The immigrants will leave overnight. But as the issue needs to be given true answers and serious answers. There are those who take advantage of that and collect votes, and they become political leaders. So a non-issue becomes issue. Now, you will tell me what is the solution to that. I don't know what is the solution to that because I have not experienced this situation for a long time. But I know that only together in the European Union we can do something together. First of all, together to protect together the borderline of Europe. Because if we, the Greeks, are not good enough to protect our borders, they will come to you anyway. So it's your problem. So we need to protect the borders. But protecting the borders is almost nothing, because humanitarian law will always make us rescue the people, and we have to rescue the people. And it is so human to rescue the people. Then, according to Dublin 1 and 2, those who come to Greece should continue being in Greece. How many can they, of them be in Greece? And they don't want to stay in Greece. Why should they want to stay in Greece? They will go to more wealthy parts of Europe. So we need to change those rules and put an end to failed policies which have transformed today the eastern islands of Greece in open prisons where you can have any girl for 1 euro or 2 or 5. We need to, in Europe, to start thinking together, not only in terms of economy, not only how we are going to create a common market, but in order to create common policies on other issues, to be together and produce solutions, because otherwise the populists who propose solutions will prevail, and that would be the end of it.
But that's a very good point. And yesterday we had Farid's on this stage supporting Europe, and I will quote him. He said, "There are no solutions to EU problems than more Europe," which is very much in line with your views. And he also said, "Things are not that bad," which is also very good news. And above all, because he's American. It's not an European saying this, it's an American and an experienced journalist who said that things are not that bad and we need more Europe. And before passing the floor to the audience, I would like to have from you, and again, very short statements, what gives you hope? So the title of the session, it's about crisis and the problems that we have in Europe, in the world, in particular, in the Arab world. So I will turn this upside down and I will ask you, what gives you hope? When you wake up in the morning, what really makes you move? Anna.
That's very easy. Youth, children. I'm a mother, I'm a university professor, so of course that's what gives me hope. And also what gives me hope is the causes that moves today's youngest generation to act. And in the case of this European Parliament election, it was obvious that climate change really galvanized people to vote and the youngest people to vote, this time to vote. So for me, it was very inspiring to see that there is a transnational movement in order to give more Europe, to boost Europe with more instruments, but at the same time, to demand more from Europe. When young people see Europe, they don't give a green card, they give a yellow card, because they say, we want Europe, we want more Europe, there are a lot of things that we have to improve. You mentioned Farid Zakaria's statement. I always like to one saying of Martin Schulz, the former European Parliament president, that in 2016 he made a metaphor with a bike, and he said, we, the European Union, we continue to be a bike, but without air in the tires. We have numerous problems to solve. We continue pedaling, though our instruments are not in the best shape. I think the fact that the EU, the European Union, and the EU institutions and leaders recognize that we are not in the best shape, even if we sometimes are in the different and opposite directions, it is also very important to see that we can move to solutions because we identify the problem. And I don't think that we are facing now a problem or a clash of identity. We are facing a clash of expectations. We are not facing a problem of fear. We are facing a problem of freedom. We are urging for more freedom of fear, from hope, but mainly we are urging from freedom, security, and justice as a third pillar of the Maastricht Treaty gave us, and that's what European Union citizens also want.
Ronen, what gives you hope when you wake up in the morning and you think you can change the world?
I think that what gives me hope is, in a way, I think that Professor Markovic mentioned it, the definition of crisis is not just a negative phenomena. It's also a potential opportunities and the need to leverage opportunities. When I look around in my country, in the region, in the entire world, I see a critical mass of people who are still seeking to leverage opportunities that have been created by crisis management. Now, if you see people around you suffering from crises, but continue thinking of what we can do in order to improve our lives, and the increased kind of cooperation. And so I see that critical mass, and I see people are looking for that, and it gives me hope. Because, look, at the end of the day, conflicts and crisis, the way we refer to them, or the kind of crisis we refer to them, are crises that have to do with human behavior, more than anything else. We're not talking about tsunamis, it's not the climate that we're talking about. We're talking about movements of people, about political movement, political leaderships. It's about people. And as long as there is a critical mass of people who are looking for solutions, it gives me hope.
Very good, Spiridon. Before passing the floor to this
we have created a Europe, a European Union, which we are very proud of, but which up to now has only given solutions and answers to the problems of the past. We don't have wars anymore. We have a common market. But we have not solved the problem of togetherness. At the end of the day, each state is for itself. And when you have crisis, everyone forgets that we are all together and wants to protect its own society and its own state. You see that very dramatically if you are abroad, if you go to Africa, if you go to Asia, you don't see European Union. You see French interests promoted, German interests promoted, Greek interests promoted. Eventually, also, we need the help of the European Union, if we do. Otherwise, everyone is for its own. This needs to change. And we saw that in the crisis of the 10 last years with the Greeks. We saw it in a very bitter way because apart from the mistakes which we made, we heard that we are corrupt when the company which corrupted the political system of Greece was German, Siemens. But we were to blame because we were corrupt. We heard that we don't work as much as we should, and we don't go to bed very early in the evening, and we like to have to encounter beautiful women. You know, this is deep in the way of thinking of the peoples. It needs to change. We need to create a Europe where we will respect each other and we sit down to solve the problems of today and of the future. We solve the problems of the past, period. We need to see in togetherness how we can develop a European society with mutual respect and togetherness.
Thank you very much. So now the floor is yours. I would ask you to be short and crispy in your questions, and please address it to one of our speakers.
Thank you very much. My name is Vitor Coyes. I followed with much interest the interventions of the speakers. I agree with Dr. Hoffman when he says that the crisis results from a clash of identities. And in fact, in order to give humanity some hope in terms of trying to solve the, or at least to mitigate the crisis, we have to recognize the right of the others to existence. And I wonder, and many times, why doesn't Israel recognize the right of the Palestinian people to exist, to have their own state? I think that by pulverizing their territory, by using construction of new buildings as a means of, as a weapon of war, Israel is preventing the rest of humanity to have some hope on the solution of the problem and the crisis in that area of the world. So there is a resolution of the United Nations which recommends the recognition of two states. We need two states in Palestine. We need Israel as the right to exist, but also the Palestinians have the right to exist and to have their own state. Thank you very much.
Can I?
Ronen, it's for you. And then we do have also a question over there. Yes, but first Ronen will address.
So thank you very much for the question. I really appreciate it. And I'm happy to answer because fortunately, I haven't been just an academic, but I'm a practitioner. And I worked very closely with two Israeli prime ministers, and I've been witness to the political negotiations with the Palestinians very closely. And I've been witness to at least two or maybe three Israeli prime ministers along the years who have suggested, offered to the Palestinians not just two-state solution, but almost everything they demanded. I worked with Prime Minister Rabin, who signed the Oslo Accords, and in exchange, we got a wave of suicide bombing in the streets of Tel Aviv and Jerusalem. I worked with Ehud Barak, the Prime Minister, who offered Yasser Arafat almost everything he demanded, and again, waves of violence from Palestinian extremists in the streets of Israel. So I don't think there is a problem in recognition within the Israeli society and even within the Israeli political leaderships along the years of the right of the Palestinians not just to exist but to have their independent state. I follow, as a politician, I follow closely also polls and surveys of public opinion. I can tell you that even now, more than 60% of the Israelis support two-state solution. So we're talking about a clear majority of Israelis who support it. But about 80% of those 60% among the Israelis who support two-state solution do not believe it's achievable because we don't see on the other side any reasonable political leaderships on the Palestinian side to sit with us and to accept it. So, you know, when we speak academically in theories, it's a nice argument to say that Israel doesn't recognize the but I've been there. And so, you know, with all due respect, you cannot sell it to me. I've been there, I saw how the Palestinian political leadership's time and again rejecting almost any proposal that we've put on the table.
Another question in the back. Yes? Unless it's also about the two-state solution. It's the same question? Okay, so. It's not the same, so please. It's the last question, I'm afraid, because then I would like to hear our chairman.
I don't Okay.
Yes, it is. It works.
So good morning. Thank you so much for this panel. First of all, thank you to the professor and Isabel Xavier for the vote of confidence in the youth. And second, it's again to Professor Ronen. You were saying that Israel respects Palestinians and etc., and that you are trying to respect their rights, but please tell me how bombing an hospital and killing more than 500 children is respecting their rights and is recognizing their right to exist and is trying to give them the right to exist and the right to their lands. How prohibiting their access to water, to land, and etc. is giving them rights. I mean, for me, this is just a massive opposition to their rights. I mean, you are bombing children. 500, I mean, more than 500 children have been bombing, have been bombed in a hospital by the Israeli forces.
We got a question, so again,
sure.
Back to the article.
Thank you for the question. I don't know if you're aware of the fact that Israel has disengaged from Gaza back in 2009, and Israel has no territorial dimension or territorial demands on Gaza altogether. And I don't know if you're aware of the fact that in winter of 2006, there were free elections in Gaza, and that we supported it completely. And the political power who has been elected is the Hamas in Gaza, in those free elections. So, and I don't know if you're aware of the fact that shooting from hospitals, it's not a choice of the people, obviously not the choice of the Israeli public or the Israeli political leadership, but it's the choice of the Hamas regime who use the people in the hospitals as human shields when they target not our soldiers, but they target our children. I don't know if you ever lived in a situation where you had only 15 seconds to run to the shelter when you hear the siren and you're a little kid. So again, I think we were more than generous. I support two-state solution. I support full peace with the Palestinians. I even, you know, unlike the majority of the Israelis, I support even to negotiate with more extreme kind of groups, because if you don't negotiate with your real enemy, there's no point of negotiations. Just tell me how you can convince these regimes, Hamas, ISIS, you know, these extremists, to stop holding their own people as hostages, come to negotiating table, and be reasonable in order to be able to find some kind of solution. We're there, we're waiting, we are ready for peace. Just please show me who are the reasonable partners on the other side who would come, shake hands, and speak reasonably with us. Thank you.
Okay, since we had two questions, Ronen, and I will give 15 seconds to Spiridon and to Anna just to close, and I would call also Arye to conclude the session. So first we will hear from them, 10 seconds, 15 seconds, and then I will invite you to join us. Spiridon, 10 seconds to
Thank
close.
Thank you very much. It's been, first of all, an honor to be in this panel. And we need more Europe. And we need a Europe where everyone will be equal to everyone and understanding of everyone for new policies solving problems of the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Anna. To close.
Just to very quickly to close, I think that it's important to remind that for 70 years now, within Europe, we are not facing war. This new generation doesn't know what war is. They know what is peace. Positive peace in terms of a welfare state and negative peace, absence of war. I think it will be up to us more than ever to actually foster that process of integration, to actually foster what Europe we want, aware that we are facing new battlefields. Now war is in the digital arena, not as in the past, that we are facing a strategic environment that is changing every day and every day. And we, within that strategic environment, there's only one solution for Europe, is to be more Europe and to have a more concrete answer and solution for all the problems that citizens want to face and are facing in the next upcoming years.
Thank you very much. So now I would pass the floor to Arye to conclude this panel. And I think I'm delivering a more positive
okay,
panel.
Well, I'm the chairless chair. So I, 1 minute or 2 minutes, it's impossible to summarize that. But I want to refer to several points that we learned from this session. We learned that terrorism, migration, are transnational threats. They are related to democracy. Ronen had the impossible mission of explaining the Israel-Palestinian conflict in 10 minutes. We need an entire day for that. I would disagree that the problem has to do with the regimes, because Israel has made peace with non-democratic countries. But you're right that it's the only liberal democracy within the state of Israel, not in the territories, of course. Jordan and Lebanon are half free. All the others are going Freedom House are not free. We learned from Spiridon Flogatis that there is an interrelation between several issues: human trafficking, human smuggling, migration. We mix them all. So we have refugees and migration. And then you move to the question how to resolve that. I think everybody agrees more or less, again, the Israel-Palestinian conflict should be two states for two peoples, back to 181. The problem you have right now is Netanyahu and Abbas. Probably the two of them stick to the status quo. We don't have time to get into that. And regarding Europe, Anna gave us a half full, half a empty glass, because and the two of you agree, I mean, on the problem of solidarity. At the same time, the EU has been doing not a bad job. So I would add on a personal note, and that's what I tell my Israeli students for 27 years, what gives me hope here, Europe. So this is what Zachariah said yesterday. 75 years of peace after the Franco-Prussian War, World War I, World War II, there is hope. Every war can be resolved. Eventually, that will happen. How long will it take? Jews, we are still waiting for the Messiah. Thank you.
Thank you very much for joining during this this session. And I ask again a big round of applause for our three speakers, who in the end gave us a bit more hopeful future in Europe and in the world. Thank you very much.